going to be in the book of Kings, 1 Kings 19. We're going to share about a famous man of God, Elijah.
Yeah.
I say famous because this guy was such a powerful instrument in the kingdom of God. The God used it in a mighty way. Just the same way that he wants to practically use you and use me. Because God always has a plan for ourselves. He wants to bless us, just like he blessed Brother Joshua with his own house. He blessed me. When I moved to Washington, I had nothing. I don't even speak English. And God has blessed me. He gave me a family, a house, and my own business that I've been running for the last 16 years. I'm a painter by trade. I paint. When people ask me, what do you paint? I say, I paint anything. Just put it in front of me. I don't care. I love painting, you know. If I don't know how, I learn. That's how I always say it. If I don't know how, I will learn, but I love painting. And that's one of the things that, you know, I always tell people, if you want to do something in life, make sure you're doing it because you love it, not just because you have to. When you want to do things because you have to, it's different, but when you love to do something, you have a goal in mind, that's a big difference. When you have that mentality of, I got to do my best because I want to be somebody, I want to do right, you know, and that's what it is. Sometimes you have to do the sacrifice, and it's not going to be easy. So in the Bible, we're going to read in 1 Kings 19, and I was going to start in the verse 8, but I'm going to start from the beginning because I'm going to kind of break it in. We're going to go pretty much to 9:18, but I'm going to go very fast. Hopefully you guys understand my language, my English. Never went to school, but by the grace of God, I learned. So let's start. Father God, we pray in the name of Jesus this morning that this word that you put in my heart to share many times, many weeks ago, Father God, that you put in my heart to share with your people, that this word, Father God, be of encouragement for their soul, Father God, for their life, Father God. We know that it's a voice out there, Father God, that always tells us that things are going to go a different way than what you have in mind, Father God, but we know that that's the voice of the devil, Father God. Because that's all he wants to do with us as Christians, Father God. He wants to ruin everything, Father God. Just like your word say in Ecclesiastes, Father God, say that, I believe it's 10:9, Father God, they say that a dead fly can ruin the perfume of the perfumist, the one who made it, can make it stink. And that's what the devil wants to do, Father God. He wants to sneak in the church and make things go bad. Father God, he wants to ruin your word. He wants to ruin your kingdom, Father God. But we know that you are mighty and powerful, Father God.
Yes.
We know that if we learn to walk with you, Father God, and stay by your word, Father God, we know, and for those who don't know, they have to know today, Father God, that your word is a lamp unto our feet, and you're going to guide us through in this day, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So as the story goes here about Elisha, how Jezebel in the Bible is an example, biblically, in reality she was a woman, regular woman like any other woman, human being like any other human being, just because it say a woman doesn't mean men are all there, right? Because we all fit under the God eye of human beings, we all humans. So just as a woman, we all can fail as men too. And this woman was so bitter, so angry, with everything that the people of God was doing. Now when she find out that Elijah has done a lot of good things for the Lord, she got angry and she tried to kill him, okay? So let's go to the number 4. But he himself went a day journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a boom tree. And another scripture uses a different name of tree. And another scripture uses a different name for a boom tree, okay? And he asked that he might, and he asked God, I prefer to die, he said. He was so discouraged, this man was so discouraged when this woman, when the devil, let's say it this way, right? When the devil came and said, I'm gonna destroy you. He was very afraid. If you think about it, you know, this man, biblically, if you go back, if you read the story, or if you know the story of this man, he was very strong Christian, very strong follower of God. He got a very good reputation as a man of God. But sometimes this little voice, this voice come to our ears sometimes when we're trying to do something for God and get into our mind and give us that fear that this woman did to this man of God. So he had to come to the point where he had to run out of town and go hide himself. Yeah. And he went to lay down by this tree. And he said that he preferred to be died. Wow. And in his life now, okay, he asked God, he said, "Oh Lord, take away my life, for I am no better than than my father's." See, he was considering himself less than anybody else. And that's what the devil wants to make us feel. Trust me, brothers and sisters, the devil wants to make you feel like a you nobody.
Come on,
amen. He wants to make you feel like a you nobody. But the truth is, that's the truth. Sometimes, yeah, it's more powerful people than ours there. You know, more powerful people, people who know more of the Word of God, people who have done more things for the Word of God, for the Lord. And we haven't done that far. So the truth is, we may be not better than other people, but the fact is that we are, with Christ, all things are possible. And that we can come and overcome anything, any situation that the devil throw our ways. We have to understand that this woman tried to scare the man of God, and she did a good job that make this poor guy run away and go sleep under the boom tree, the Bible say. Then in the verse 5 say, "And he lay down and asleep under a boom tree, and behold, an angel touched him and said to him, 'Arise and eat.' And he looked, and behold, there was above his head there was a cake, fresh cake baked, and hot stones and a jar of water." I tell you this, this man cannot complain.
Come on.
Why? Because even though he wanted to die, he was going through a situation where he knew that he had to do something for God. He was a man of God. But he wanted to die because he couldn't take those words in his head. So God's provision always is going to be there for us. The way out of our life is going to be there for us, other situation. And the best example that the Bible can give us is this: God is concerned about you.
Yes, amen. Come on.
If you look at it, you say, "Well, I guess he's concerned about me being healthy and strong and have enough strength to go, to live." And yes, God knows your needs. I was hoping to, after I shared the message, I was hoping to do the offertory, because this is what I believe in reality. You want to think about it. And I ask you to please think about it. The Bible says that God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but of courage and the power. So, sometimes even with the offering, we're afraid to give. Come on, brothers and sisters. I have not seen a Christian die for starvation. I have not seen a Christian. Yes, you might see somebody who claimed to be a Christian kicked out of their house. But I tell you what, personally, I have seen the power of God in my life, how God has come through in my life, how he has blessed me. I shared this story one time when I got cut out. I was already married, and they cut off my power, the electricity. I shared this story how God worked in my life, and I was already a Christian. I remember I was without power for a few days. Then this guy who lived above us in the apartment above, he noticed that we don't have power. And he was a drug addict, very strong drug addict. You can see it, all this freak tripping, you know? And he said, "Hey, you need power?" And I said, "Well, I would love to." He said, "Okay, I hope you are." He threw me an extension cord, and I put power in my refrigerator, which is the main thing. You know, this is people who do not probably believe in God, but they're in their own world doing things. God always provides a way. Amen. I remember a few days later at the church, when we were in the church, this brother came to me and he said, "Here, brother," and he gave me an envelope and he gave me the money, a check in the envelope. It was the exact same amount that I needed to turn my power on. This is the God that I'm talking about. This is the God that we're looking over here that is telling him, "Get up and eat. There is some food, there is some water, drink, get your strength back. Come on, wake up. You know, those things are the ones who we need to consider and remember as Christians in our daily walk. You know, arise and eat, he said. Then we continue on. After he did it, he said, and he ate and drank and lay down again. There's nothing wrong. He needed to rest, right? And the angel of the Lord came again, second time, and touched him and said, arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you. And he arose, ate and drank. And he went in the strength of that food for 40 days and 40 nights. Wow, just there is another miracle. 40 days and 40 nights with one meal. I don't think pastor can do that, really. I know he's a pastor, he's a man of God, but I don't think he can do it. I don't think anybody, we know, nobody here can do it. You know, no matter how many tacos I eat, I don't think so. I might do it like him, I go back to sleep after this, you know. But the truth is, sometimes God wants to do things to us. He provides, he takes care of us, he guides us, he gives us what we need, but it's not going to be just for our enjoyment, okay? So the Bible says that he after that, he got up and eat and went in his journey. And arose and went for 40 days and 40 nights. So number 9 says, then he came to a cave and launched in it. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and he said to him, what are you doing here, Tyrone? And this is an example. What are you doing here, Mario? Why do we run away sometimes? Why do we try to hide ourselves? Why do we find a cave to lay down and hide? It has to be an explanation. And if we go through things in life, sometimes I tell you the truth, sometimes when I have come home from work, and all I want to do is just get in my room, close the door, close the windows, and just chill out. Because things are going too strong, too hard for me. And this is what this man did, practically, and went and hide. But this is the word of the Lord saying, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant. Throw down your altars and kill your prophet with the sword. He said, and I even only left, the only one left. And they seek my life to take it away. See, look at it. A man of God who has fought so much, who has killed so much, who has conquered so much land, so much victories. Now he is afraid. Why? For that little voice. For that voice who say that I'm going to get you. The voice that we always hear as Christians, you're not going to make it this month. The voice that say to you, well, if you go and help, you know, you're not going to be able to be there on time for this and this thing. Oh, you work hard this week, you don't have to go to church. The word that say, if you give all that money, you probably don't have enough to eat. That voice that always, it's going to be against the will of God in our life. This was a man of God with a purpose. God had a purpose in his life, and that purpose, we're going to find it after we read a little longer. That purpose is very important. God has a purpose for you and I, brothers and sisters, and he wants to bless you. He wants to use you. He wants to show you glory through you, just like he has done through me. The other day I was driving here in downtown Everett, when I found a couple of coupons for discounting McDonald's. So I was hungry, I said, what the heck, I'm gonna eat this thing, you know? So I got out of my car, and as I get out of the car, I see this young guy coming to me, and I said, oh, there it comes, one of those beggars for money. In my mind, you know, that was my flesh. And he come to me and he say, he's speaking Spanish, if I have a dollar. And I say, yeah, you know, what you need it for? He said, I wanna eat something. I said, are you hungry? He said, yeah. Well, they come in, I buy you food. So I invited to eat food, and he was so happy, walked inside with me, ordered the food. I was able to use both of the coupons that I have. And we ate, and we were sitting there, and I started to witness to him. And this young man started to tell me that how he got fired from his work. He came from Iowa, but he really wanted to get his life right. He wanted to work hard. He had a lot of goals, practically, in his mind. He has a lot of desires, a lot of things that he wanted to do with his life. But he came to the conclusion that he was messing up because he always had the weakness that if somebody come to him with something to make it stupid, like drugs or alcohol, he always fell for. So I was witnessing to him about my testimony, how God had changed my life and things like that, how God had blessed me. And then next thing I know, he's crying. And I look at him and I say, well, obviously this guy wants to change. And I start to share God with him, share Christ with him, and he just say, man, I just would like to be able to get back home again, start again, fresh, you know. And I just told him, hey, I tell you the truth, I tried many things in my life to change. I tried to change myself. Many times I quit my alcohol, my drugs and everything. But it came a point, I told him, when I was three times I was dying for overdose of drugs and alcohol, in 1 month, three times, I said, I had to come to the conclusion, and I had to face it. I can't do this anymore. I can't. And that's when I cried to God, I said, God, help me, I can change. And this guy was looking at me like, man, I think this is what I need to do. So after all, we eat, we talk, and you know, we laugh a little bit, and I pray for him. I said, do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? And he said, yes, I know. So I said, I don't need to, you know, tell you anymore. You know the truth. The Bible said that when you know the truth, the truth will make you free. And the truth is the word of God. God has so many promises in his word that he always want to take care of us. He has a lot of examples, like this cake, the baked cake, fresh, nice and warm, that was cooked over warm stones, you know, the water, what we mostly need in life. You know, our body is mostly water. So this is a way how God provides for us, even though in the time of trouble. But we fail as humans. We fail because we listen to the little voice and we believe it. Okay? So let's continue reading a little bit more here. So then we were, when he went to the cave and he asked him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, throw down your altars and killed your prophet with the sword. And I even only I am left, and they seek my life to take it away. 11 say, and he said, go out, stand out at the mountain before the Lord, and behold, the Lord passed by in a great and a strong wind. Okay? A strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in there in the wind. Listen to this. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. If you think about it, wind has done it does damage, big time. We just had a little storm last time. Remember how many people were without power? Earthquakes. Why are we gonna go there? Earthquakes, nobody wants an earthquake in their town. You know, I live already through three earthquakes in my life, big ones. So I know what it is. You know, I know the damage. I know the struggle that people go through. I know the pain. I know the sorrow. You know, I know what those things can do to you. Just like the storm when hit Louisiana, how dangerous, how much damage. Then the fire. Fire consumes things. Fire gets rid of things. Fire clean out mountains. Destroy houses. What can fire do? A lot of damage. Okay? So let's continue here. Then, but God was not in the fire. Then he said, after the fire, the sound of a low whispered voice. And Elijah heard it. I tell you what, these examples, the wind, it can get loud. And you know, if you hear wind sometimes, you leave your window cracked open and you hear it, and it's very windy, you can hear this noise. through the whole house. An earthquake is loud and that's a lot of stuff. The fire. Those things are loud and powerful. But the example here, the blessing comes when that little still voice came to Elijah. God is a gentle God. Sometimes we look in those big things in life for help. People go to these famous miracles, crusades, go to famous psychics, people that are famous, they are great in the world for help. When we all have to do is just stay still and obey the word of God and listen to God's voice. God's voice is not going to be loud as an earthquake, or as a wind, or destructive as fire. But this guy finally got it. Yes. And the Bible says, number 13, and when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloth and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Why did he cover his face? Because we feel ashamed sometimes. When we find out that we did the wrong thing, we feel ashamed, right? It's very normal to feel shame. Why? Because when you feel shame, it's because you recognize that you were wrong. And when we're wrong, we know we feel bad about it. We don't want people to see us, right? That's what this man did. But even though he feels shame, he stood up and went out. Okay? And behold, there came a voice to him. Say here in number, we continue number, what were we? 13. And we call him a voice to him and say, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he say, I have been very jealous twice, the same excuse, all right? It's easy to put excuses, right?
Come on,
right? Twice the same. I have been very jealous for the Lord of God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant. Throw down your altars and kill the prophet. The same old, right? But I only left. And they want to kill me, he said. And the Lord said to him, go, return to your way, to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king, Jehu to be another man of God that was God wanted him to be, and Elijah. So he mentioned three people that God wanted him, Elijah, to go and anoint him to do the work of God. But this is the message here. I want you to pay attention. Return on your way. God always shows us many ways. Finally, he said, okay, I took care of you. You remember? You were hungry? I took care of you. Remember you were thirsty? I took care of you. Amen? He throw examples to see where we are. He want us to be ourselves. He want us to be those men and women of God that he has called to serve him. And he say, get up and return. Go back and go and anoint these three men. See the lovely thing about these three persons, three words, three men in the Bible is Hazael, which means God has seen. God's already seen. God knew. God already have seen everything before you even got there. He has already a way for us to get out of there, but sometimes our stubbornness, or pityness. We want to feel like people to feel pity for us. Oh, well, they killed everybody. I think they tried to kill me too. You know? They got a system, so it's okay. Now I think I'm next. And you see, we always look for excuses. We always repeat the same excuse. You know, we always looking for the way out. When we know that the call of God and this man was to serve God, to obey his word, and to be strong. Why? Because God has a purpose. What was the purpose of this man of God? To go and anoint these prophets, these men of God. Okay, Jehu means Jehovah is him. God is God and He's powerful. He said in the Bible, I am who I am.
Yeah.
He is only the only one that we need in life. But no, sometimes we want to hear another voices. We let these voices control our mind. Then the other one, Elisha. Elisha means God is my salvation. After God knew God was God, and the salvation for this man was Elisha. God had a plan to save his people. Because if you read, continue reading here, it says, well, that's when God sent it. And after all, he thought it was only him. In his mind, he's like, whoa, I'm the only one left, I guess. I better die then. But no, it was 100 people waiting. Still was a lot of people there, but we don't get to see those situations. Because the devil is a liar. He always tries to freak you out. He always tries to make you feel like whatever you're doing is not working. Whatever you have done doesn't mean nothing anymore. And this is the when we miss the point. We miss the point of what God wants for us. I want to go to another scripture. Okay? And this is going to be the last thing we want to read, because I really think that God has spoken His word. I do believe that God wants to share with you guys to be strong. To don't listen to those voices. But remember, no noise, greater noise or greater impact can change the voice of God, because the word of God is soft. When He wants to speak, you don't need to scream like a whisper to our children. I told you to stop it. You know, we go nuts, you know what I mean? I have kids, so I know how they were. I've seen it many times. So let's go back in here. And now we're going to go to the book of Luke. Luke 10. And we're going to start at number 38. Luke 10:38. And this is the story of Martha and Mary. Okay? Martha and Mary. The name of the message that I wanted to share with you was Martha, Martha. Jose, Mario, Mario, Tyrone, Tyrone, hello. Now as they went out on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listening to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving.
Come on.
Okay, distracted with much. Sometimes we get too much. We don't have too much things going on. We don't pay attention to what God's doing. And she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her to help me. Sometimes we even want to give orders to God. Hey, did you see me? See what I'm going through here? I try to do everything that you want me to do. You know, when we hear the voice that say, you see, everything you're doing, you can interpret it your own way. You see, for nothing, look at what you're doing, look at what you have done. But look, this voice is in your head. Look, everybody else doing something else, why you have to stress about it? So then Jesus answered to her and said, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things. But one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion. Okay? The good portion. You have to make the choice to choose the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. What is not going to be taken away from a Christian is the love of God, the knowledge of God, and the peace of God. If you're really hungry to do something for God in this life, you want to do something for God, you have a goal in mind, but you hear these voices telling you, hey, come on, help me out. Look, I'm doing everything by myself. Look at, you know, look at what you have done. It's, no, it doesn't mean nothing. Come on, we have another things to do. Forget it. Sometimes those voices can distract us for what God has in mind for us. God has a marvelous plan for every one of us. Everyone that is in here is not a coincidence. Trust me, the brother was just sharing the testimony today about how he was missing so much church because he'd work. Finally, he quit the job, got another one, making almost twice the money. Praise God. God has a plan for you.
Come
God has a plan for everybody. He wants to see you overcome. But we have to remember, all we have to do is stay still and listen to the voice of God. There's many people who are going to come to you and tell you, oh, this and that's going to happen, God's going to bless you. Is that the voice of God? The word of God is the voice of God. You don't know how to listen to God, learn how to read His word, and you will find the answer.